with all the news from WTCN-TV's expanded news gathering facility.
WTCN-TV, channeling.
This is Care 11 News at 10.
Hi, everyone. I'm Paul Majors. Are you ready to go underwater? Well, this evening, there's no need to be a registered diver, just a little willingness to dive deep into your imagination, because together we're going to embark on a dry voyage beneath lake, river, and sea, a magical journey you won't soon forget. Welcome to Magic of the Deep, the Underwater World Special.
Under the sea, darling, it's bitter down where it's wetter, take it from me. I'm on the shore, they work all day, out in the sun, they slave away, while we've been voting full time to floating under the sea.
For as long as man has been around, there has always been an intrigue with the sea. Not much of a surprise, considering the fact that 75% of the Earth's surface is covered with water. But it wasn't until 1852 that the Zoological Society of London opened the very first public aquarium, simply known as the Fish House. Well, aquariums have come a long way since then. All around the world, oceans and lakes have been brought to the public via aquariums. But not until just recently has the public had the opportunity to be brought to the depths of the ocean. A little bit of magic that started as a dream.
The dream began with one man's love for the sea, Kelly Tarleton, a fearless diver and sea explorer who faced challenges and dangers that more often than not resulted in success.
His dream was to introduce the general public to ocean life, but he wasn't content in merely bringing fish into man's environment. His desire was to bring man to the depths of the sea. In January of 1985, Kelly Tarleton realized his dream as Underwater World in New Zealand opened its undersea adventure to enthusiastic crowds. It would be less than 2 months from that climatic day, Kelly Tarleton would breathe his final breath. Though Kelly is no longer with us, his dream remains alive, ingrained with passion in the heart of this man, Eric Pedersen. Eric is the president of Tarleton Aquastar, so named after the legendary sea explorer. For Eric, taking on this ocean-sized project has been long and hard. But was it worth the wait?
This exhibit, I can tell you, goes beyond my expectations. The tunnel concept under the water, the variety of species, the lighting, the way it's set up, the reef, everything is just absolutely wonderful.
The most common question Eric had to face was, why are you putting a 1.2 million gallon ocean in the basement of a mall in the middle of Minnesota?
I have never seen a place that is so focused on nature and what happens in nature and fishing and fish in general. The inspiration of the project from the community and from the surrounding waters is fabulous. And
I don't think people realize that there was a basement in the Mall of America.
No. No, because in fact, when people tell me when I say Mall of America, they say, well, where? I said, well, in the basement. They said, there is no basement. I said, yes, there's a basement. They said, well, how big? It can't be very big. And I say, oh, it's only about an acre, two stories.
By early May of 1995, the construction management team of Lear, McGovern, and Bovis had begun this ambitious project. One of the many challenges that they faced was maintaining an active construction site while being surrounded by up to 70,000 visitors a day here at the Mall of America. Greeted by an expansive space larger than a football field, first objective?
We had to take 1 foot of dirt off the entire area of this place, and the only way to get it out was in buckets.
20,000 buckets, equaling about 4 million pounds of dirt, or how about lugging in 300 tons of reinforced steel to go along with the 6 million pounds of concrete being pumped through the mall via a 500-foot pipe and poured in the middle of the night. Well, if that's not enough to make your mental muscles sore, think about hauling 400,000 pounds of sand and coral gravel for the tanks themselves, or perhaps in terms we can better understand, that would be 8,050 pound bags, certainly no backyard sandbox. One of the greatest physical challenges was assembling the 27 sections of the 400-foot-long, 55,000-pound acrylic tunnel the old-fashioned way.
Well, you couldn't do it with a crane or anything. We had a roof over our head, so it's kind of like almost the same technology they used to build the pyramids, which they hadn't used to set all the acrylic in place.
But construction of the facility was only part of the puzzle. The fabrication and installation of the exhibitory elements is where the personality of the project began to take shape.
I was going to ask about the waterfall over here. What's the drop? What do we have over there?
He's very interactive and very concerned about the product. Really helps us take pride in the work. We want to do the best work for a client who shows such an interest.
I mean, what I would like to have in here is just sort of the sound of the wind blowing through the trees and in the forest. So it's like you see it, you feel it, you smell it, and you're in the forest.
Combining the trained skills of specialists from around the nation, multi-sensory underwater world begins to take form.
You've done a good job here,
Mindy.
You have.
Beautiful indeed. This is a place where magic truly is being created from a dream. And a little later on, we'll see this dream come to life.
Well, that's only the beginning of the dream known as Underwater World. Now it's time to go fishing for a little taste of how the land of 10,000 lakes was brought to the Mall of America. Stay with us.
By the sea.
By the sea.
By the beautiful sea.
You and me.
You and me.
Welcome back to Magic of the Deep, the Underwater World special. As Minnesotans, we take pride in the natural beauty of our forests, lakes, and wildlife, not to mention our fish population. And now Underwater World at the Mall of America has made it possible for the rest of the world to come and experience a little bit of Minnesota magic, both above the water and below.
This pond has about 5,000 fish in it.
Despite being rich in fish and water, finding enough finny stars for the Minnesota display presented its own challenge.
At first it was kind of mind-boggling, but it starts off with a lot of phone calls, sourcing different fish, finding out the hatcheries that have the fish that I need available to us.
Here in the spring-fed ponds at Trout Air, Jesse Kleiner is looking for suitable trout, some big rainbows, plump browns, and dainty brookies.
Here's a nice brown trout.
More than 80 trout will be sorted and judged big enough or just the right size for Underwater World. With 25 years of fish raising experience, Kleiner enjoyed the task.
Yep, it was exciting to be involved with it and a little bit different, so a good adventure for me.
But as any Minnesota angler knows, not every fish comes easy. In a nearby pond, it was time to round up the king of freshwater fish.
Now this is a muskie, the most elusive game fish in Minnesota. And at Underwater World, of course, we'll be able to see them anytime we'd like. On the other hand, they'll be able to see us too.
True to its reputation, the king also was the most elusive in more ways than one.
Oh!
Well, there really isn't a big demand for big muskies. They're not, as you know, not that tasty. It's just not the type of fish that anybody really, really wants except for the muskie fishermen.
With the help of DNR fish managers, these muskies were trapped from lakes that'll surprise most folks.
Right from the Twin Cities area, they're averaging size from probably 36 to 48 inches.
Oh, those
so
are
some,
nice.
Some nice honkers, yeah. Yeah, we'll be proud.
In fact, many fish heading for Underwater World first spent time in a most unlikely setting, a factory warehouse in Hopkins.
All right, we got some gars. This is going to be a nice addition to the aquarium.
Once at home in the Mississippi River, now heading for the river in the mall.
Very prehistoric, very heavy scales. They're air breathers. They've got long jaws, and they catch their prey by slashing sideways.
On this day, the Hopkins warehouse is like a busy fishing dock. Bass and crappies come in. Would you believe albino catfish? And a few fish that anglers seldom see.
Yeah, now this is the bowfin, otherwise known as the dogfish, but if you see that long fin on the top, that dorsal fin, that's the characteristic of the dogfish. That's one you'll catch hook and line once in a while.
However, Minnesota's most famous fish also proved hard to find.
Well, believe it or not, walleye.
What? Walleye's the most difficult to obtain?
So far, we haven't been able to get too much in the way of numbers for the walleye.
Fact is, many anglers could make the same claim about having difficulty finding walleyes, but that indeed is the promised magic of Underwater World. When you go fishing, sooner or later, you wonder what the fish are doing down there in a Minnesota lake or river. Now we don't have to wonder anymore. I'm Ron Shera, Minnesota Bound.
Did you get a good look at that big muskie? I think that's the one that got away from me last year. Well, Makes for a good fish story anyway. Hey, speaking of fish stories, when we come back, we're going to take you on an exciting sea hunt in an attempt to bring home to the Northland some colorful tropicals as well as a quest for some elusive shark. This one's no fishtail.
You know, come to think of it, it's more like, actually, you know, if the truth be told, the one that got away was more probably in the range that was a huge.
Welcome back, everyone. Have you ever wondered how aquariums get their fish? Well, the responsibility of filling underwater world with over 8,000 fish is enough to bring even the most avid of fishermen a bit of anxiety. With quite a number of fish coming from warmer waters, we headed south to get acquainted with a few of our tropical friends who would soon call Minnesota home.
It's the land of Ernest Hemingway and Margaritaville. Spectacular sunsets, endless oceans, the Florida Keys, where tourists outnumber the natives 8-1, and nobody's ever in much of a hurry to get anywhere. If you make a decent living here, and not everyone does, your job probably involves the ocean. That's just fine with Forrest Young. He's part scientist, part businessman, part Jacques Cousteau.
Okay, I'm ready to go in.
When he's not on the ocean, he's in it. In simple terms, he's a fisherman, but unlike any fisherman you've ever met.
We catch them underwater with hand nets, bring them back to the boat in little special containers that we carry on our backs or on our belts.
Forrest is a fish collector. Aquariums all over the world call him with orders. His best hunting spots are coral reefs. Natural bridges and small crevices offer perfect hiding spots. Forrest will spend hours on scouting trips, eventually filling orders for aquariums from Madrid to Minnesota. Here, he's found a school of fish called Sergeant Majors, so named for their stripes, and a couple of unwanted guests. See how the school steers a wide path around the two big fish in the upper left? They're barracuda. Nasty teeth, bad disposition. But today, no appetite. They leave the school, Forrest, and photographer Tom Impey alone.
Not all of the tropical fish are caught with a net. In fact, the old rod and reel is standard gear as well. Believe it or not, they can come out here in an afternoon and literally catch hundreds of these. Just like this. The old Sergeant Major, and he's heading to the Mall of America.
But when these fish get to Minnesota, they need to be as spunky as they were in the wild. This one is a blue-striped grunt. Forrest netted him in about 60 feet of water. Change in pressure from the ocean floor to the surface left the grunt and several dozen other fish slightly bloated. Not life-threatening, but uncomfortable. So, with a small needle and a gentle poke in the rear, pressure is gone.
With the sun going down, that means the day's work on the water is coming to an end. But that doesn't mean the work is coming to an end. In fact, the real serious work is just about to begin.
Underwater world. Four big jacks. You want to do some rays, Timothy? Please, Timothy?
In this ramshackle setting, organization is critical. A dozen people carefully packing and shipping live fish. Tonight's will go to Minnesota. In many cases, one fish per bag, half filled with seawater, half filled with pure oxygen.
If we can take a small animal, put him into an aquarium in the middle of Minnesota, and let all the citizens of the state of Minnesota come and view these animals, we create an ecological awareness in people that have never seen the sea.
That was a brown shark, 7 feet and several hundred pounds. One of two held in a 50-foot shark tank on Big Pine Key, Florida. Both will be big stars at Underwater World. They love raw meat, but not cameras. Dave Casey is the shark man of the Florida Keys. His only job, capturing big sharks and stingrays. Today, he's taking us out on a shark hunt. Forrest Young is also shark hunting, but he generally captures much smaller fish. However, today, he's got an order from Underwater World for a 6-foot nurse shark. Dave will take us out 10 miles. He'll go sharking with hooks and bait. Forrest will take us out about 10 yards. He'll go sharking with bare hands and a net. Only one will bring home what he's after. Tucker is Dave Casey's first mate. He's running out 6,000 feet of line, 700-pound test, 200 feet of water. Each hook gets a pound or so of fresh bait. The bloodier, the better. Sharks can smell blood from miles away. Forrest is diving for his target in literally 10 feet of water. He's found a boat dock where nurse sharks sleep during the day.
Looking good, man. I'm gonna catch sharks today.
Back on Dave's boat, Tucker is confident. It takes them an hour to bait 100 hooks. The seas are heavy. They'll wait another hour before checking their luck. Under the dock, Forrest zeroes in on his targets. Half a dozen nurse sharks right where he expected them.
What I do is I get up to the ledge and I look over underneath and see how the animals are laying, and then I select a target animal based upon his proximity and his direction. If he's facing me, I can grab a hold of him, pull him out, and shove him into the bag before he knows what's happening.
Forrest sprays a small amount of a special anesthetic into the hole, just enough to take the edge off the shark and reduce the chances the 6-foot-long wild animal will hurt itself or Forrest during the capture. Dave and Tucker use a motorized boom to pull in their lines. Hook after hook comes back untouched. Dave starts to worry.
That's not a good sign when all the bait's coming back up, nothing gone.
But several minutes into the retrieval, the line tightens.
That's something there, isn't it? Swimming, whatever it is.
Dave and Tucker spend several minutes pulling in more line until they spot the animal. A huge rough-tail stingray. 8 feet from nose to tail, 6 feet from wingtip to wingtip. A big prize, too big it turns out to handle. Dave was after sharks anyway. The ray will be there another day.
I think we got skunked.
Near the dock, Forrest will try to get his shark to swim head first into his net. If he misses, he runs the risk of antagonizing the shark. Docile or not, a mad shark is trouble. Forrest holds the head near his own and tries to control the tail. He will literally walk back to the boat. At one point, Forrest loses his grip and the muscle-bound shark rolls him over. But within 5 minutes, he's back at the boat.
Big one this time.
Forrest will catch one more before heading straight back and getting the sharks into a bigger, more comfortable tank. Dave calls it a day. He returns home to feed the two browns already waiting for a plane ride to Minnesota. Sharks, he says, are perceived as the ocean's bad boys, routinely killed in the open sea, slaughtered in commercial fishing nets. Capturing a few for public display, he says, will help people realize sharks are worth saving.
For Underwater World, education is as important an element as entertainment, and with the aquarium near completion, the fish ready to take the journey to their final new plush abode, one important stage remains. That's bringing the fish home. We'll be right back with the final wave.
Under the sea, under the sea. Since life is sweet here, we got to be here.
Welcome back, everyone. I hope you've been enjoying our wet and wild adventure. So far, we've taken you under the mall, over the tanks, from the cold waters of Minnesota to the warm tropics of the Gulf, behind the scenes and in front of a shark. But now we're going to take you to the final wave. It's time for Eric Patterson's magical dream to be filled with life.
Okay, everybody out.
The final wave has arrived, and Underwater World at Mall of America will soon be filled with a wet population of gills and fins. The temporarily constructed holding facility in Hopkins has functioned as a fish hotel of sorts, as thousands of fish have been housed, or should I say tanked here, awaiting delivery to their final destination. An intricate system of pumps, filters, and pipes make certain water conditions are no less than ideal for this underwater neighborhood.
Speaking of intricate systems, there's 50 pumps, 27 high-pressured sand filters, and 4 miles of pipes. All of that is the heartbeat behind the 4 enormous tanks at Underwater World, all a part of keeping the aquarium fully cleaned and treated. All told, 1.2 million gallons of water is fully recycled every 2 hours. And for you mathematicians, that's 166 gallons per second.
The water is stabilized, and the time has come for the final and possibly most critical phase of the project. The fish are coming home. Less than a week from the aquarium's grand opening, a few familiar faces show up at Minneapolis-St. Paul International Airport. Dave and Tucker, along with several of their prize catches, nurse shark, brown shark, and some stingrays. These pool sharks will soon be checking out their new domain, but first, transport and delivery is critical and, of course, potentially dangerous.
It takes a lot of awareness of what the animal is like, what the capabilities are, and the animal's dangerous at both ends. It's got teeth at one end and a very powerful tail at the other. They'll be handled in a special stretcher that we use. They're especially constructed for moving large animals such as sharks. And we'll bring them into this point, into the water. The sharks will still be a little groggy. We have to be doubly careful because sharks will just kind of lash out at things because they are groggy and not really aware of their surroundings. So it means that we have to watch not only taking care of the animals, but watch that we're not in danger at that point.
Well, as the opening of Underwater World nears, one big question remains. Are the people going to have more fun viewing the fish, or are these fish going to have more fun viewing the people? Well, maybe we just ought to ask the fish.
Well, I'm not so sure the fish have a lot to say, but from what I can tell, it looks like the fish have a pretty good angle on the human terrarium down here. This is certainly an underwater experience like no other, and you can have the same experience as I'm having with one big difference. You get to stay dry as you glide through along the 400-foot-long moving walkway under the lakes of Minnesota, through the Mississippi River, where I'm hanging out, into the Gulf of Mexico, and finally the colorful coral reef. This is a must-see attraction for every age, and you can leave your bathing suit at home.
Staying dry while underwater is a specialty at Underwater World. But this dry excursion beneath the sea is more than just entertainment. Underwater World is an incredible resource for obtaining a deeper understanding of the aquatic environment. Education is available for young and old alike with Tarleton Aquastar's special educational programs. If you're interested in acquiring information on how you can benefit from these valuable programs, just write to Underwater World, 120 East Broadway, Mall of America, Bloomington, Minnesota. The zip code is 55425. Underwater World at the Mall of America will be celebrating its grand opening this Friday, June 14th. It really should be quite a splash. I'd encourage you to take part by visiting this world-class exhibit as soon as you can. Thanks for being a part of our journey into the magic of the deep. I'm Paul Majors for Care 11. We'll see you in a little while at 10.